Hi everyone, I'm Christy and welcome to Lifesprings Online. We're so excited that you chose to worship with us today. If this is your first time, please scan the QR code on the screen so that we can connect with you and give you a free gift. If you want to stay up to date on all that's going on at Lifesprings Church, text 411 to the number on the screen and you'll see everything going on. If you would, take a moment and share this broadcast and don't forget to like and subscribe on all of our social media platforms, including Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, and YouTube. The more you do, the further the gospel spreads on social media. We've got a great service in store for you today, and we want you to get ready to worship God. So, for those of you with kids, go ahead and get them ready for their own service by heading over to lifesprings.online/kids for a virtual kids service. All right, it's time for worship. Go ahead, get yourself pumped, and if you're physically able, feel free to stand. Then let's make wherever you are a place of worship so that you can lean in to the presence of God.
Praise, treasures of faith, never enough. Such an awesome God. Let's give him some praise. Tell the
Come on, does anybody know he's worthy of praise? Let's give him a hand clap of praise. Hey, I'm Jonathan. I'm the campus pastor at our Selma location. I just want to take a moment, and maybe you're here and you've experienced God before, and you know exactly what that song means when it says he's worthy of it all. Has anybody ever experienced the greatness of God? Come on, somebody. How about the fact that he saved you? Anybody thankful for that? The fact that he helped you when it didn't seem possible. The fact that that marriage looked like it was messed up, but God showed up. The times when you didn't have money and God was there and he provided. He's worthy of it, isn't it, somebody? He's worthy of it all. And so what the song says is that every day and every night there's going to be praises rising up. Why? Because the people of God know that he's worthy of it. In fact, Revelation chapter 5, verse 11, this is when Jesus has shown up on the scene and all these angels, all these people are gathered around, and it says thousands upon thousands, 10,000s times 10,000s are singing, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wealth and riches and glory and honor." Because that's who Jesus is. He's worthy of it all. And maybe you're here today and you're new to this whole Christian thing, or maybe you've never committed your life to God. And you think, why are they celebrating? Here's why. Because when it was impossible, God showed up. When those marriages were messed up, God showed up. When you heard the C word, and I ain't talking COVID, God showed up and they were healed. He's worthy. Would you say that with me? One, two, three. He's worthy. He's worthy of it all. And so you can experience God's grace too. Because if he never did another thing, he saved us from our sins. And that's available for you too. So here's what I want to do. We're going to celebrate communion in just a moment. In fact, we're going to be doing this the first weekend of every month here in 2023. Because he is worthy of it all. So I want to pray for you. If you would, just close your eyes where you're at. Maybe you're here today, or maybe you're tuning in online. And you realize you're far from God, but you want to be close. You want to experience the excitement of those who are in this room today. There's not a special prayer you've got to say. All you have to do is accept that Jesus is your Lord, believe it in your heart, and confess with your mouth your sins. All you got to do is just say something similar to this. Just say, "God, forgive me of my sins. Help me to live like your son. And help me to serve you till the day I die." If you say a prayer like that, you're just as much a Christian as I am. Maybe you're in this room today and you need something from God. And you know he's worthy of it all. You know he has the power to do it all. But you want him to show up where you're at today. Father, I pray for those in this room, for those online, those in the party room, wherever else under the sound of my voice. I pray that you would bless them, use them, do inside of them whatever it is that they need. Because we love you and we need you. In Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Hey, as we get ready to take communion, I want to invite you to grab one of these little cups that's there in the seat back in front of you. Maybe you're online. I want to pause this. Go get some bread. Go get some juice, cracker, whatever it is. Because we're going to celebrate communion together. And the beauty about communion, it's a symbol. It kind of reminds me like the other day when my daughter, she came into the room and she just jumped right in my lap and she gave me a big kiss on the cheek. Come on, you parents, you know you love it when the kids do that, right? You assume they want something from you. But she said, "Daddy, I just love you." Can I just tell you, Jesus coming to this earth, dying on that cross for our sins, is his way of just saying, "Hey, I just love you." So what we're going to do is we're going to participate in this communion to remind us of the love of God. So if you would, just go ahead and get ready. Open up that first layer, that little film, and you've got a little wafer there. Just hold it up high. The Bible says that on the night that Jesus was going to be betrayed, he had his disciples, his followers, in an upper room, and together they were going to have their last dinner. They didn't know it was his last, but he did. So he took that bread, he broke it and gave it to everybody in the room, and he said, "This is my body which is broken for you. As often as you eat this bread, do it in remembrance of me. So let's do that together. Right after that, Jesus took a cup, had juice or whatever in it. He started to pass it around. And he said, this is my blood that's going to be shed for you. Now, a lot of times we get scared about blood because blood carries diseases. But can I tell you, the blood of Jesus washes away all diseases, washes away all sins. And so on that day, Jesus set up a new covenant. And he said, on this day, if you believe in me, my blood is shed for you. And you can be in relationship with God. So he gave that cup. And he said, as often as you drink this cup, do it in remembrance of me. So let's drink this cup together. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for that love letter you sent 2,000 years ago. When you knew where we would be right here in 2023, you knew the issues we'd have, you knew the valleys that we'd face, you knew the turmoil that we'd be in the middle of, and yet you sent Jesus all those years ago to live a perfect life on this earth, because we can't, to be a perfect sacrifice that was worthy of it all, that we could be in relationship with you. So God, I pray that this bread, I pray that this cup would remind us of your sacrifice to let us know it's going to be okay. We're in relationship with you, and you've got us where you want us to be. We love you, and we need you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Would you say that with me? 1, 2, 3. In Jesus' name we pray, and everyone said, amen. Amen. Hey, let's give God another hand clap of praise. Go ahead and have a seat if you would. How many are glad you came to church today? Anybody? Amen. Well, hey, we're in a new series, or we've been in a series for a few weeks now. Pastor Dale's been bringing it. Have y'all enjoyed this series? Amen. It's been incredible. And we've got something special for you today, because we like to celebrate when God's people do things to shape culture around us. And we've done that in a lot of ways. So today, we have a special thing for you. We have some folks from our church who have published a book and published a song, and Pastor Dale's going to talk about that in just a minute, but it fits so good to this sermon. We wanted you to see it because it's getting released really soon. So check out this video.
Inside my mind, these fears they criticize every piece of me till I can barely breathe. My thoughts they race so fast, stuck in an overcast. I feel the heaviness. Oh Lord, I need some rest. Then I hear you say, breathe. Mm-hmm. Then I hear you say, breathe. Child, I hear you. Oh, child, you see. You don't need no one, no one but me. Yeah, breathe, breathe. Yeah, breathe, breathe. I run so far away, pretend that I'm okay, but in reality, I'm falling far. So far. God, I hear you. Oh God, I see. I don't need no one, but you hear me.
Yeah, come on, you can stand up. Yeah, come on, let's stand. Incredible. Incredible. Amen. Amen. High five somebody and say, that's some of our family. Go ahead and do that right now. That's some of, amen. You can be seated. I want to say hello to everybody in here, everybody that's worshiping today in the lounge or in the party room or online and Harnett County, Johnston County, Lee County, all of our Lifesprings family everywhere. Do me a favor and say hello to all of them right now. Come on, get loud again. Thanks for tuning in. Thanks for tuning in. I want to tell you about the video you just saw, but first, let's go ahead and start taking care of some of these things. And if you want to follow along today, I've got some verses, not as many as I was going to have because the Lord has laid it on my heart. I believe He's going to do a deep healing in you today, and I want to make sure we have time at the end of this service because I really believe God's going to do some work that preachers can't do and songs can't do and flowers can't do and books can't do and anything. I think He's going to touch some places that only God can touch in your life. Come on, somebody, say, I receive it. I believe that. So go ahead and text sermon, though, to get the notes today. And if you want to need somebody to pray with you, text prayer to that. And to that number, 919-586-8900. It would be an honor to pray for you and to help you. So, and I want to let you know about what you just saw. What you just saw was Kennedy Clayton, who has grown up for years in our church. And she's now grown up, got a big girl job. She's a dental hygienist. She's part of our praise team. She's a part of my small group, the small group my wife and I is a part of, and she writes music. And so she wrote this song, and she's very public about this. I don't think I'm saying anything I know I'm not saying anything she hadn't said publicly, but I wouldn't dare want to tell her story. But just like so many of us, she struggled with anxiety and things, and she wrote this song. She felt the Holy Spirit downloaded it to her, which fits so well with our series. And here's the deal. It's dropping. It's coming out. It came out, if you're watching this after this, on February the 3rd, you can buy this song and you can get it anywhere they sell music. Can we celebrate that right now? I'm excited. Hey, Kennedy, stand up. Stand up. Kennedy's actually in this service. Come on, welcome. Good job, young lady. Good job. Good job. Now, it also said at the end of it, just because I want to give honor where honor is due, it said at the end of it, it says it was directed by Micah Tyler. And somebody's like, man, he's pretty famous. Okay, he is, but he's not the one you're thinking about, okay? The Micah Tyler that did that is actually also in our church family and part of our praise team and had been a part of our church for a long time. Hey, we got some talented bunch of folks in here, right? She wrote the song, he directed the video. Incredible, incredible. All right, so while we're on that, I also want to take just a second and highlight something else in case you don't know it. We finished this past week, for those that have been doing the church devotional, we finished the devotional, Good Shepherd, I think. I read it every day. I don't know what name of it is. Good Shepherd. And it was a great devotional. Did anybody do it? Did you get something out of it? So let me hear. Amen. Incredible. Now, with that being said, let's keep it going. How many of you can raise your hand and say, I believe that I ought to stay in God's Word? Hold your hands up. Good night. Okay, we have another lady in our church family, this lady right here, beautiful lady, married to this beast, ugly, beast, you know, like I don't even, are they here? I don't know, are they here? Okay, man, it's not even fun when he's not here. This is Ashley and Eric Braxton, and she actually started the Braxton Family Book. She's a teacher over at Lee Senior or Southern? Lee Senior, Southern, woo! Got a little bit of fire when I said that. Anyway, she at Southern. She's a teacher at Southern, great teacher. And God has called her to write books, and so she's going to do children's books, a lot of books. She's been planning this for a while, but it was very important to her to come out with her first book in January 1st. Why? Because we're order is restored. What? And she wanted that first book to be a Christian book released 1st of January 2023. I had a chance to review a lot of it before it went to print, and it is released. It's called Joyful Noise, and you can scan this QR code, and you can buy it. It's at Amazon, and it's the first of many books coming. What she's done is she's got a 15-day devotional where she goes through and songs that have meant a lot to her. That's a lot of them, most of them, we sing right here in our church, and she's tied that to scriptures and given you homework for you to go through and research some things about it so you can learn more about who God is to speak to you on a deep level. Now, here's the cool thing that she is going to actually, she comes to church here. Her and her family are group leaders and involved all over the church. I don't even know where all, I wouldn't even dare list all the places they serve, everywhere you see them. But she's going to be at the Sanford campus on February 5th, is that right? Yeah, February the 5th, signing books. We're going to have them in the bookstore here. They're not here. They will be on February 5th, and then she'll be at the Stanley campus on February the 9th, also signing books. If you want to buy them here, or if you want to order them offline and be here, she'll sign them. And then if the people at Selma or Western Harnett, I've not talked to her about it, but I believe we can twist her arm. If you guys want that, you make sure you let us know, and we'll try to get those down there to you. And hey, can we just celebrate? Listen, here's what I want to say before you clap. I want the church to influence every arena of society. I want business leaders that are anointed. I want people writing songs. I want people writing books. I want people in politics. Hey, if this world has ever needed Christians, they need us now with positive messages, positive material. Can we celebrate for the people in our church family who realize that they've got a talent and God saved them? And come on, let's celebrate right now. It's incredible. Thank you. Okay, I got a sermon to preach to you, and then we're gonna make sure we have time. Hopefully, I'm gonna do my best. When we went to preachers' meeting we sat down and talked about the sermon with all the preachers that are gonna be preaching it. And we talked through it, and they're like, "Oh, we can say this, and we can say that." And I heard this, and I heard that. And we got this illustrating, and I said, "You know what? We could. I got a lot of things I could say about the subject we're talking about. I have dialed it down. I cut out a third. Now I don't know how long the sermon's gonna be, but I cut out a third of the message. True story, because I wanted to save time for you." I really believe with all my heart, I've been praying for you hard, that God is going to do a big work in you. Come on. Amen? So we're in a series called 1, 2, 3 called Guaranteed. And it's on what book of the Bible? And what chapter? Book and chapter? What? Psalms. And we're doing this for those that are watching online in what year? Because we believe this is going to be a prophetic word for us as we carry it through the year. And it's going to help you, because I've never seen a group of people that need to stop and breathe like the song talked about, because we're so wigged out like now. And I believe this is going to be something you need to memorize and you need to quote it back to yourself all of this year and remember. And so what Psalms 23 is about is it's telling us, God's saying, this is who I am and this is what I'm like. So if you don't know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, great series to be a part of, great sermon to be a part of. And he says, this is what I'm about. This is who I am. And here's what we're learning. The more you know about God, the more you trust him. And the more you trust him, the less you worry. And the less you worry, the less you panic and anxiety. Does that make sense to you? You see the natural? So we've talked about in this series, we've talked about worry. I'm in part 5. So before that, leading up to it, we've talked about worry. And we've talked about chaos, when you just live in chaos and busyness and run around. We've talked about when you live with indecisiveness, just can't make a decision, and how that tears you up. We've talked about dark valleys, when you go through bad things. And today, what I want to talk about today is I want to talk about the title of the message. I titled it, it's like, that hurt, you know? You ever had anybody hit you something and say, that hurt? I want to talk to you today about damaged emotions. I want to talk to you about hurt that goes unresolved and lays dormant in our body. And here's something. I don't know if you've ever seen this verse before, but I love this verse. I've never preached on it, but I don't think a lot of people's ever heard it. Here's our Lifespring Church social media moment. Take a picture of it and post it and put it somewhere. You keep track, and he's talking to God, you keep track of all my sorrows. Have you thought of that? Like, we know God keeps track, like, in our mind, God keeps track of all of our sins. We know God keeps track of all of our good deeds. He says he writes that down, and you can't even give a glass of cold water and he won't remember it in heaven. But did you know he keeps track of all your hurts? You keep track of all my sorrows. You have collected all my tears in your bottle. You know, why would he collect something like that? You want me to tell you why? Because your tears matter to God. You know why your tears matter to God? Because you matter to God. I've collected your tears in your mind. You have recorded each one in your book. How many of you think that's a pretty incredible passage? Hold your hands up, good night. I do too. You may need to remember that this year as you go through that. Here's the thing. We all get hurt. We all process pain differently. Now, my sister, when she got hurt or when she got upset, and she still does today, she cries. And she don't just cry. My sister, her whole body cries. Y'all ever seen somebody whose whole body cries? Like at funerals, we'd have to sit on the back row because we'd need to escort her out because everything, she'd start shaking. And, you know, just because it's her whole body cries. She gets ugly cry. Who knows what I'm talking about right there, right? Okay, I'm the opposite. I'm the one growing up who I have to, and I still do this, honestly, I have to process pain privately. I was not the kid, you know, when kids get hurt, they want mama, mama. I was not that kid. When I got hurt, my mom would tell you, I didn't want anybody holding me. I didn't want anybody cuddling me. I didn't want anybody coddling me. I wanted to be left alone. My dad's like that. I have to think it through. I have to process it. I have to use my head to get through this. And because of that, and I'm not just, emotion bothers me. Like, I don't know how to deal with emotion because to me, emotion is just totally unhelpful whenever I'm going hurt. I don't understand. Now, somebody's like, you are a cold somebody. I didn't say I won't. I'm just being honest, okay? This is the way I function. I struggle with it because emotion becomes unhelpful for me, and I have to try to pull emotion. Some of you are nodding, and some of you are judging. I don't like the looks I'm getting right now. I have to pull the emotion out of it, think it through, and then make a decision, and then that's the way I get through it. Now, other people are not like that. Some people, whenever they get hurt, all they need is a good cry. And yeah, some of us like, amen. You gotta preach it, brother. Right now, right? And once they cry, they're good. Okay, which is the right way? Which one wrong way? It doesn't matter. Either way is the right way. Either way is the wrong way. Does that make sense? It's like we're all different. So hurt is like, if you want to look at it like this, hurt is like fire, and we're like substance. Whenever you put fire to gasoline, sometimes they explode. Some of you just get mad when you get hurt. Sometimes when you put fire to metal, it just glows. Some of you just glow. So when you put metal, when you put fire to ice, it just melts. Some of you just cry, you know, whatever. But what is, it's the same fire, it's just different material. We're all made different, right? If you don't think people are made different, go to Walmart and just sit on a bench and watch. We're all different, right? Everybody's different, but here's the thing that we all have in common. Everybody has pain. We just process the pain different. How many of you are tracking with me? Hold your hand up so far. Today, the passage we're looking at this week is, read it with me out loud. This is from Psalms 23, verse 5. We're at verse 5, the fifth part of the sermon. Ready? 1, 2, 3. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. That's what we're talking about today. Because we live in an imperfect world, you're going to be hurt. In fact, let me just go ahead and be honest, in case you don't know this. The deepest hurts you will probably ever have come from people. And let me go a little bit further. The deepest hurts you have not only come from people, they'll probably come from the people that are closest to you. It's a funny thing in life. The greatest blessings you'll ever have, the greatest joys you ever have are the people that are closest to you. But the greatest source of pain you ever have will usually come from the people that are closest to you as well. Because it hurts, it hits different, don't it? It matters different. Sometimes those people will hurt you intentionally. Sometimes those people will hurt you unintentionally. Sometimes those people will hurt you accidentally, and sometimes they will hurt you on purpose. Now, here's the thing, what I've learned, our response to that hurt matters a great deal. Some of you are like, it don't really matter how I respond as long as I just get through it and do it. No, no, no. I have been doing this ministry thing for a long time, and let me tell you what I have learned. The way you handle hurt when it happens to you, the way you process it, I have learned that some people mess their whole life up by the way they handle hurt. I've watched people spin out of control because here's what I've learned. I have learned that when you don't handle things right, things will go from bad to worse. And what I have watched, and I need some of you to tune in, you will develop things like trust issues. And you'll stiff-arm everybody in your life because of some past hurt that is there, and you'll die a lonely person. I've watched people develop anger issues because of something that happened, and they're just mad. Pastor Shane and I have an expression. We'll talk about somebody said that person has a mad white boy syndrome. You ever known them? Don't look at them. Just say amen me right now, right? I've also noticed that people sometimes, the way they handle hurt, they'll get into substance abuse of some sort. They'll try to drink it away or drug it away or whatever. I've noticed some people would just get bitter and very negative and cynical about life. And every time you talk to them, it just aggravates the daylights out of you. Come on, you know what I'm talking about? Because they bother you. I have watched people get hurt and allow that hurt to destroy them. And watch this, I have watched people get hurt and allow that hurt to destroy almost every relationship in their life. I have watched people have a marriage that they let just dwindle away because of some hurt. They wouldn't work through the conflict in the marriage. I've watched people let a hurt make them just lose all of their relationships at work and isolate themselves. I have watched people cut off all their friendships because they feel like everybody's gossiping about them and everybody, and because of a hurt, they cut off everybody. Do y'all know? Are y'all with me right now? Does anybody nod at me? Let me tell you some things. I didn't put verses because, again, I'm trying to make sure I get through the sermon. But I'm going to give you four things I've noticed, and I could give you a verse for every one of these. I just don't have time. Of poor ways I've seen people deal with hurt in their life. And here's, so I put it like this. When you're hurt, don't. I'm going to say don't do that. I'm going to show it because I want you to make sure you know these are negative. Don't lie about it. The first thing is don't lie about it. People, I've watched them do this. They pretend it doesn't hurt. Like they'll say, you know, somebody hurts us, and they'll be like, oh, it won't make a big deal. I didn't even notice that. It didn't even bother me. Yeah, right. You ain't slept for 2 nights. You've been. That's all you've thought about. But just, you ain't a big deal. Now, listen. I'm not saying everybody needs to walk around and be hypersensitive. That's one thing I've been scared about preaching this message, because I don't want all of you going around talking about, that hurt me. That hurt me. That hurt me. Okay. Some of you need to relax a little bit. You're too sensitive. We're living in a world that is offended by everything. Come on, y'all know what I'm talking about. But I'm talking about when it really hurts, there's no sin in saying, hey, that hurt. You don't have to make a big deal out of it. You don't have to talk about it for 6 months. But there's nothing macho. I mean, there's nothing that's not macho. There's nothing not manly. There's nothing weak about saying, that hurt me. And what I've learned is ignoring hurt never heals. Ignored hurt. People say, well, time heals all wounds. I really don't know if that's true. I've never heard my doctor say that. I've never heard my doctor say, just ignore it. It goes away. In fact, what I've heard my doctor say is sometimes when you ignore it, it makes it worse. I have heard doctors say that if you don't acknowledge the pain, you could actually have a small problem now and a bigger problem later on, because you can turn a minor problem into a major problem by not dealing with it. Because why? Let me tell you about wounds, in case you don't know this. They get infected. They fester and they spread. And your first husband did this, but because you didn't deal with it right and you jumped straight into other relationships, who then compounded the hurt, and now you've got this big old baggage suitcase you're bringing in every relationship you've got. Am I preaching okay right now? Is this, don't lie about it. Let me tell you something else. Here's something else you don't do. When you're hurt, don't run from it. It's human nature to run from trouble. Doors in public places open to go outside because we panic, and when we panic, we bolt. And what I have learned, when people get hurt, they immediately try to escape that. They try to escape it with alcoholism, or they try to escape it with drugs, or they try to escape it with divorce. Just walk. When the going gets tough, they just walk out. That's what they don't work. They try to escape it with hobbies, just staying busy and staying gone, not have to deal with it. They try to escape it with busyness, just working all the time, all the overtime. Hey, they try to... Boy, I bet I'm going to see some elbows on this one. They try to escape it with retail therapy. Get in a lot of debt and manage that. I've watched this happen. And why? Here's the problem. Where's the problem? Whenever you sober up, you got the same problem. When you got to make the payments, you got the same problem. When you go to the next marriage, you got the same problem. It's the same thing. Nothing changed. That's the problem with it. Don't try to camouflage it. Don't lie about it. Don't run from it. Don't camouflage it. You know what camouflage it is? It's where you try to keep it to yourself and you don't tell anybody, and we wear like masks. One thing I loved about COVID is that whenever you had a bump or something, you could just wear a mask and put it on, right? And some of you ladies are like, man, I didn't even have to do makeup, but from here up, that was it, you know, right? for a year there. It was just, you could cover it up. You could wear, here, we wear nice clothes and we go around and we got this pleasant smile and we're carrying all this hurt and we got all these dumb things we say and we're just trying to care. How you doing, brother? I'm blessed and highly favored. How you? I'm fine as frog hair split three ways. If I was any better, I'd be twins. And the people that are closest to us, they're like, are you okay? I'm fine. Is something wrong? Nothing's wrong. Are you sure you're all right? I'm all right. You don't act all right. But we're trying to act all right. And here's what happens. We're fake. We're fake. We're walking around fake. We're walking around, I look good. But here's the truth. If you could just get real, if you could just take your and get honest about who you are, you'd be like, this is what I look like emotionally. I look like hamburger meat inside, man. I've been abandoned. I've been abused. I've been hurt. And I'm telling you, listen. And see, here's the thing. It is so hard for men to admit this stuff. In fact, some of you right now aren't even listening to my sermon because you think I'm talking to a bunch of sissies and a bunch of girls because you were told you never can look like this. And here's the thing about me, and let me tell you what I've learned. It took me a long time to realize this. Ladies, you're not even going to get this, but guys, you're going to. The only emotion that I was taught it's okay for a man to show, not by my dad, but by society. The only emotion I was taught that men could show and be okay with was anger. So when my feelings got hurt, I got mad. When somebody did something wrong to me, I got mad. It was like that's the only compartment I had. I didn't know. And I'm walking around toe up from the flow up. Trying to find ways to let nobody see what's hidden inside. Because I'm just angry. Because that's the only compartment I knew to deal with. Y'all know who anybody tracking or am I to... So we disguise it. We disguise it, put it on, and just carry it around. Do I look good? Doing all right? Fine as frog hair, split three ways. Hanging in there like a hair in a biscuit. And all those other things. Now, I'm not saying we need to walk around bleeding on everybody, but come on, y'all know what I'm talking about. Anybody here, don't raise your hand. Anybody here feel like you live in a fake and a lie? Sometimes, and you think if people really knew how bad I hurt, it's not helping. When you're hurt, don't lie about it, don't run from it, don't camouflage it, and don't dwell on it either. See, some of you just live in there. I'm going to give you a word. Don't rehearse it, release it. Did you hear that? Don't rehearse it. Release it. Rehearsing never helps. We become bitter. We become angry. We become cynical. We become closed in. We become self-pitying. And bitterness will hurt you. I'm telling you, let me listen. I know some of you had some major trauma. You've been molested. You've been raped. You've been cheated on. But let me, and I know this is going to seem so counterintuitive. And see, you're feeling like you need to have that pain validated. And I understand that. But listen to me. Bitterness hurts you far more than anything else could hurt you. I've worked with a lot of people through the years, and the longer you carry the bitterness, no matter who hurt you and what they did, you carrying the bitterness will actually hurt you worse. If it will kill you, eat you up from the inside out. It's like a parasite. Bitterness and unforgiveness, it just, let me tell you what it does. It perpetuates the hurt. Your bitterness and you dwelling on it is becoming conduit so that the hurt from your childhood and the past, you dwelling on it, and that it is the conduit to make it come into the present. And as a result, it's hurting every relationship in your life. If I've hurt my arm and a scab on my arm and I've cut it and I've hurt myself, and you come up here and say, hey, Pastor, good to see you, I'm going to come unglued. I might even put my fist up and want to hurt. And you're like, what is wrong? You hurt me. Now, you didn't hurt me intentionally. You didn't know, but what happened is you bumped up against my unhealed scars. You see, that's what's wrong with some of you right now. Every relationship you're having is spinning out, and the reason why is because people can't get close to you without bumping up against your unhealed scars. And when you don't let it, when you rehearse it instead of releasing it, it just perpetuates the pain and the thing, and it prolongs the pain. And what's happening is you're allowing, listen to me, I need somebody to hear this. You're allowing the past hurts to control the present. Let me say it to you another way. You're allowing the people of your past to hurt you today. Not only did they hurt you then, you're letting them hurt you over and over and over again. Every time you tell the story, and what's happening is you're falling into a place that is a self-defeating position. You're in a place of self-pity and woe is me. And your kid, and they're going on with their merry life. And you're drowning in your sorrows. Okay, who's am I building a case? Are y'all with me? Anybody understanding it? Hold your hands up getting high. I want to make sure. Let me ask you a question. How many of you see some of it in yourself? Anybody other than me? Hold your hands up getting high. All right, I want to talk to you today. This is the passage we're talking about. What do you do about it? Read it again with me. 1, 2, 3. This is Psalms 23. Ready? 1, 2, 3. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Right here in Psalms 23, verse 5, the imagery changes. Before this point, we've been talking about the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He leadeth me beside still waters. He, you know, all this kind of stuff. He I lie down in green pastures and he, all this kind of stuff. Restores my soul. All right, here he's changed the imagery to now he's talking about a banquet. Now he's talking about this feast that is going on. And in there, he's going to actually give us three symbols. And I've taken those symbols and I'm going to put them like action steps of things you need to do to move past the hurt. Three things that are in this passage. Now, I don't want to oversimplify some of the hurt and trauma that some of you have had. I know that. That's why I want to give you time at the altar, because I know it gets complicated. But I think these three, maybe you need to, sometimes we need to go to counseling or whatever else, but I think these three would give us a good jump start to be able to get going. Okay, if you're ready, say ready. I'm going to give you three things. Number one, first thing I want to say, he says right here, but instead of all those other things I said, here's what I want you to do, or what he wants you to do, is let Jesus settle the score. Don't try to get even yourself. Don't try to seek revenge. Don't try to seek retaliation. Trust God to even the odds. Trust God to handle the people who's hurt you. Here's what David said. David said, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. And it's a, I hope you can see in that almost a in-your-face kind of a thing, right? Like, I'm going to get to eat in the presence of our enemies. Go back to sheep. Like, the sheep are grazing, and the wolves are standing on the outside, and they want to get to the sheep. But it's like the shepherd standing and saying, I dare you to cross and try to get one of my sheep. You come across there, and I'm going to put a what pop knot right on your head. I'm telling you. David said, I killed a lion and a bear. And so these sheep get to put their head down, and they ain't got to watch their back because they got a shepherd watching their back. You prepare a table before me. Right in their presence, right where they can see it. You see, sheep have a lot of enemies. They have a lot of things that want natural predators. They're very defenseless animals. They've got, you know, coyotes and bears and snakes and even ticks, and they don't have teeth that are able to bite like that. The way they're shaped, it's not, they can't like attack and bite. They can't run very fast. They don't have claws. They can't hide. They don't have camouflage. The only way they're going to be protected is if somebody protects them. The only way you're going to be protected is if somebody's got your back, and God says, let me handle those who hurt you. And it's not just that verse. Here's another one. Over in Romans, he said, do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. Read that highlighted part with me. Leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. God knows who's hurt you. He's collected every tear in a bottle. He's paid attention to it. He saw it. And you say, well, why hadn't he done something? Listen, you said they're still living, they're doing fine. It ain't over yet. There's coming a day when all of us will be judged before a holy God. And trust me, he's got a lot more resources to settle the score than you do. And here's what I want to say to you. You can't recover from the hurt as long as you're seeking revenge. You got to decide, do I want to get revenge or do I want to get well? Because you can't do both. Revenge keeps the hurt alive. The only relief you're ever going to feel, some of you need to amen this because they're not going to believe me when I say it, but some of you live long enough to amen it. The only relief you're going to ever feel is forgiveness. Amen. When you forgive. Because forgiveness doesn't help them, it helps you. Now, forgiveness doesn't mean that it's okay what you did to me. No, it's not okay what they did to you. And I'm also not saying, listen, you say, well, does that mean I shouldn't let the law? No. That's why we have a legal system. Let the law do its job. I mean, I'm not saying, listen, hold people accountable. I'm not saying don't, you know, the court system. I'm not saying that at all. I'm not saying hold people accountable for the wrong they did. I'm just saying, but when you feel like you've got to be the judge and the jury, are y'all tracking? When you've got to be the judge and the jury, you've crossed the line. Forgiveness is giving my hurt to God and trusting Him to settle the score. Trust God to handle the situation even when you can't. And let Him prepare a table for you right in the presence of your enemy. And here's what He says, blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. How many of you want God to show you mercy? Then you've got to model that. As I forgive others, God is able to forgive me. And the longer you try to revenge, the longer you're going to hurt. Number two, ready? Is this helpful so far? So let me see your hand right here. Okay, first thing is let Jesus settle the score. Second thing is let Jesus heal your wounds. Let Jesus heal your broken heart, heal your broken spirit, heal your wounds. Here's what He said. He said, read it with me, 1, 2, 3. You anoint my head with oil. Shepherds used oil for on the heads of sheep for two reasons. They did it to soothe and to heal. They would use it to, like a salve or an ointment, that they would soothe a sore and they would protect it with oil to keep it from being infected, to heal the sore. And He's representing Jesus, the shepherd is, that says, hey, I'm going to take care of your hurts and I'm going to comfort you. One of my favorite passages in the Bible is this right here. Read it out loud with me. 1, 2, 3. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. Isn't that great news? God's saying, not only am I going to settle the score, but I'm going to do a little repair work on your spirit in the process. Because here's the deal. Once you've forgiven, once you've decided to let something go and try to seek revenge, is all the pain gone then? No. It still hurts. Forgiveness is instantaneous, but healing and restoration, it takes time. And sometimes it takes a while. I mean, sometimes it takes weeks, sometimes it takes months, and sometimes it takes years. You know, a small cut don't need even a bandage on it. If you get a paper cut and you go wrap it up with a big old bandage, then you're a wimp. Right? Not all cuts need, but the deeper the cut, the deeper the wound, the divorce, being rejected by your parents, being molested, I don't know, the deeper the cut, the longer it's going to take for it to heal. It doesn't always heal. Now, can God do a miracle and heal instantaneously? Absolutely. But usually it takes time. The first step is forgiveness. And then you let God anoint your head with oil. How does Jesus heal hurts? What's the bandages that God uses? I didn't get this on the notes, so you're going to have to take notes and get these. I think these are very important, though. Here's some bandages that you'll see God use all the way through Scripture, and I've seen Him use in years of ministry, to heal emotion. These are the emotional bandages and salves that God put on you. Let me give you one of them, and I'm going to give you four, but the first one that I think is most important is prayer. When you pour it out to God, there's a healing virtue in that. Read Psalms. David poured out his hurt to God, and by praying and talking to God about what happened to you and who hurt you, there's a healing that happens in that. Let me tell you a second bandage that God uses with people. Christian fellowship. Now, I know fellowship's not a word we use very much today, and when we do, we have a fellowship hall, and we most of the time think that means eat, okay? All right, now, eating is very important to fellowship, but fellowship is really deeper than that. Fellowship is where Christians get together and have deep relationship. And let me tell you what I've learned about Christians when they get together and why we make such a big deal out of group. It's not because we're trying to count numbers or whatever else, but when you have Christians, they find support with each other and they do life together. And when you find support, when you tell your thing and somebody tells their thing, there's something about that that's healing that happens. That's why you need, listen, never make a habit or a decision to isolate yourself. When you do that, you set yourself. You know what? A sheep has a lot of enemies. And if you're a sheep and you're out here by yourself, the wolf's going to get on. So you even tell you what, if you're a sheep and we're all sheep, come on, can I hear a baa in the house? Right? Okay, let me tell you what a sheep needs to do. If there's the foe, you don't need to be out here by yourself. You need to find a church and you need to find a row of Christians and say, excuse me, excuse me, excuse me, excuse me, excuse me. And get right in the center of them and say, my name's Dale. Well, your name, don't say Dale. But my name's whatever. And you need to get there because why? You're going to get eat up by the devil when you're out there by yourself. Two bandages, prayer, fellowship. Let me give you a third bandage, God uses. Worship. There's a healing power in praise and worship. Let me ask you, have you ever come to church and you walk in and as soon as they hit the first note, it's like somebody turned the water faucet on? Or have you ever sat in one of these sermons, maybe this sermon's it, and it's like as soon as we started, it's like I'm dialed in and you just feel the tears? Okay, that is the healing balm of God. There's a power in that. There's a healing in His word and worship. He uses prayer, fellowship. He'll use the worship. Let me give you one more. Serving, believe it or not, is a healing bandage God uses. Serving. When you help somebody else with their hurt, somehow it helps you with your hurt. You say, explain that. I can't. It's just the way God set up the universe. And Lifespring Church has a place for you to pray. It has a place for you to worship. It has a place for you to fellowship. It has a place for you to, serve. That's the reason I call our church a hospital for the hurting. Because we're wounded soldiers healing other people that are wounded as well. Amen. Y'all got me? Amen. Now, I want you to understand a few things. I got to move on. But I want to understand two things. I want to give it a parallel here about healing away in the physical world. And I want to show you two things about that I want to show you that's going to be the same in your emotional world. Whenever you're being healed in the physical world, like you've had a surgery or you broke a bone, there's two phases to that, okay? First phase, the doctor's going to tell you if you've never had a surgery or had a broken bone, he's going to say the first stage is be still. Like, go lay in bed, don't get up. Put this thing in a cast and do not bend that elbow or whatever it is that you broke. Do not do it. It's going to be that don't move it stage. But it doesn't stay there very long, and the next stage is going to be get moving slowly stage. And most of us are not going to do that because it hurts. And so they send us to very evil people called physical therapists. Now, no offense to the physical therapist, but some of us have been there, right? Let me tell you what a physical therapist does. If this is so insensitive to me, like my knee is hurting and I go to physical therapy and she doesn't want to work on my other knee. He doesn't want to work on my elbow. He won't work on my hand. He goes right to the thing that hurts the most. Jerk. And starts manipulating that and twisting that. And I'm like, no. Can you imagine if you come to me and you say, this is a very sensitive subject for me. And I say, well, let's talk about that, baby. I don't want to talk about that. I just told you I get offended. And it's like, that's the way. Jerk. See, some of you right now, that's where you're at. You've been in the, and here's the thing. If you stay in this be still stage too long, you'll actually lose mobility. And the surgery will get reversed. And you'll actually be worse off at the end than you were in the beginning. See, some of you right now, you've been in the be still stage too long. And God is nudging you out. And He's trying to get you back involved in ministry, back involved in the game. And you're fighting Him. And you're saying, jerk. Because God's going right to your pain, right to the spot it hurts the most. And let me just tell you, you're never going to be healed if you keep sitting there wallowing in this. You got to get up and get moving. Does that make sense, everybody? Hold your hands up. All right, second thing I want to say about it, I'm relating it to physical healing. Second thing I want to say about it is even after you're completely healed, after a surgery or something, you're going to still have a scar. And that scar is going to give you a choice. When you look at the scar, you can remember all the pain that came with it, or you can look at the scar and remember the healing that came through it. And I'm encouraging you to look at it and see the healing and not the hurt. And that's a choice that you make. That is a choice that you have to make between your ears. Okay, who's still with me? Is this helpful? If so, let me hear an amen right now. I'm going to give you one more. Here we go. Ready? Settle the score. Let Jesus settle the score. Let Jesus heal your wounds. Number three, let Jesus provide for your needs. Amen. Let Jesus provide for whatever it is you need as you're healing. Here's what he says right here. He says, read it with me. My cup overflows. Now, the setting for this was in the Mideast. And in the Mideast, most of the Mideast is a desert. And so if you have a cup that's overflowing with wine or with water, whatever it is that they're putting in that cup, it's a sign of waste. When you overflow a cup, it is a sign of waste. And when you don't have much of something, you don't waste it. You're not going to waste something that you need. And he's saying right here, whenever you have a cup and it's overflowing, then it's a sign that you've got everything you need. Here's what God's saying. He said, if you will come to me and let me, and you'll look to me, I will let your cup overflow. Now, the only way you're going to do that is if you go to God. Why is that? Because, see, I'm going to send a light bulb off for somebody in here today who's not been walking with the Lord, and you've not been in quiet time, you've not been doing it. I'm going to give a light bulb for some of you. Ready? Some of the reason you've been empty inside is because you're going to people to fill your cup, and people cannot always fill your cup. You're expecting from people what only God can do. You're actually sucking the life out of your spouse. You're sucking the life out of every boyfriend you get. You're sucking the life out of all of your kids, because you're saying to your kids, you're saying to your spouse, you're saying to your boyfriends, make me happy, make me happy, make me feel good about me, make me feel secure, make me feel so secure, make me feel loved, I need to feel loved. And here's what I want to tell you, a person cannot meet your deepest needs, all of your deepest needs. Now, God uses people to help you, but God has got to be the source. And when you look to people to do what only God can do, you're going to get more hurt on top of the hurt you already have. You're going to get, I know this is getting deep, but you're going to get more disappointment on top of the disappointment you already had. God never meant for another human being to meet needs that only he can meet in your life. And as long as you keep doing that, you're going to be disappointed. Because why? That no matter how good she is, no matter how good he is, no matter how good your parents are, they're not God. Only God is God. But when you do come to God, he says that he will let your cup overflow with what? With hope. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may what? Overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. He'll fill your cup with love. And may the Lord make your love for one another and for all people grow and what? Overflow, just as your love for, just as our love for you overflows. He will fill your cup with what? With joy. He says, I have told you these things so that you will be filled with my joy. Yes, your joy will what? Who wants some of that in your life? If you're hurting, Jesus invites you to the table for an anointed. He provides you to a table in the presence of your enemies where he says, I'll take care of them. He invites you to a table when you're hurting, and he says, I will let you overflow. Let's read it again together. 1, 2, 3. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Come on, who understands this message? Hold your hands up. Will you stand with me, please? He says, I'll settle the score. Don't worry about that. I'll heal your wounds. And I'm going to provide for your needs. I feel a really moving of the Holy Spirit in here. And if you need to slip out, do. But if this is an emergency, can you give us about 3 minutes, 4 minutes, 5 minutes here? I want to start right here. If you're in this place today and you don't know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, say, Dale, I'm not a Christian, but I'm realizing I need to be. I need him to help me overflow. I'm not a Christian, but I want to be. Would you raise your hand? Ready? 1, 2, 3. Raise your hand if that's you right here. I see hands. I see one hand. Come on. Any others? Come on. Hold it up good and high. I can't see real good. Come on. I see at least one hand. I think I see two hands. Here's what I want you to do is say, God, I'm sorry for my sins. Please forgive me. From this day forward, I'll serve you today. I die. I don't deserve it. But I need your forgiveness. Please forgive me. I'll mess up, I'll fail, but I'm serving you for the rest of my life. Okay, heads bowed, eyes closed. How many of you would be honest and say, Dale, if I'm being really, really, really honest, I've got some hurts in my life that I need God to heal me from. Hold your hands up good and high. Anybody? Oh, my goodness, look at that. Almost everybody in this place. Thank you, Lord. I don't even know what to say. I got altar workers here that are ready to pray with you. But I just feel like that a lot of us just need to come to the altar. Maybe you don't even need to come to a worker. Maybe you want to. You can come to an altar worker. Maybe you just want to come and kneel down in the corner somewhere. But would you begin to ask the Holy Spirit right now to help you? Help you process this pain so that you don't keep dealing with it. It don't keep robbing you of joy. God, do a miracle. I'm going to ask the people to step out, just people to come to the altar, everybody who will, anybody that will. And I want us to sing and just let's see what the Holy Spirit's got for us. Let's lift our voices, lift our hands. Holy Spirit, do a big work right here. Do a big work.
You are the medicine, the only cure for everything I feel within.
I just feel like some of your heart's beating out of your chest right now. Don't you tune this out. Please don't run out of here. Don't hide. Step forward. Whether you step forward physically or you just step forward, lean in. Focus on these words. It's time for you to wrestle this thing to the ground. God's collecting those tears in a bottle.
You are the truest friend. Staying through the night when I was down.
I just feel like there's somebody here and you've never even come to the altar.
Comforting my heart.
And I'm not begging you to come for me. But you need to step forward. And when you do, here's what you're doing. You're stepping out of the pain and you're walking to the cross. You're walking to God. Come on. Physically, you need to do that right now. I'm leaving this behind. Come on. Step out. Just step out. It's hard to do that when you've never done it. Maybe you didn't grow up in a church like that or whatever. I promise we're not going to get on you. Nothing. It's a symbolic act. I'm stepping out of this pain. I'm not carrying this anymore. I'm laying this down right now. I just feel like you need to step. You need to come. I just feel the Holy Spirit saying to somebody, you need to, and when you come, it's like you're leaving right there in that seat, all that bondage and all that baggage. Come on right now. This is what we're stepping to healing. Somebody who's got an anger inside of you. You've had an anger. You don't even know why. Little things just set you off. Heal it, God.
Everlasting Father,
heal it, God, right now. Cool their boiling hearts. Pour like a soothing oil over that blister that's been fire hot all their life. You've been so mad at your dad. You've been so angry at your parents, your mom. You shouldn't have had to grow up like that. No kid should have had to go through that. Your kid should have wondered about that love. Let God heal that right now. Somebody here, your first marriage just about did you in, man. You got all this trust issues, all that stuff. You had a boyfriend, maybe you're a teenager in high school and you had somebody who did something and you never told anybody. You just kept it bottled up inside. He's the medicine. He's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He's here right now. It's time for you to leave that behind and get healing from that. Deep work, but you've got to allow him. It's time for you to step towards him right now. I don't care if you come to the altar or not, but you've got to step out of your pain and into healing. You've got to let God begin to work on that knee that hurts the most and touch those areas that hurt the most.
They say it, all I stand in awe.
You're the medicine. You're the healer. You're the one. You're the everlasting Father. You're the answer. You've been looking for answers in all the wrong places. You've been trying to self-medicate. It's taking a little more wine every day, isn't it? It's time. It's time to step out of that. Come on, sing it again, one more time.
Wonderful Counselor, government is resting on your shoulders. Oh, you are an everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, Emmanuel, God with us. You're here, right here.
Thank you guys for watching with us. We hope you heard from God today. Don't forget to scan the QR code so that we can give you your free gift. And again, don't forget to text 411 to stay up to date on all that's happening at Lifesprings Church. And now here's our online pastor, Pastor Jonathan, to close out the service.
As we get ready to close out the service, we want to take a moment and continue this atmosphere of worship through giving. And if this is your first time, please do not give. We did not invite you here for your money. But what we do want you to know is that God loves you. But if you're ready to take your next step and worship God through giving, we encourage you to go to Lifesprings.online and you can give right there. And there's other ways as well. But I want to go ahead and close out this service by praying for you and for this offering. So let's pray. Father, thank you so much for what you're doing in this year. 2023 is going to be, I believe, somebody's best year yet. So Lord, I pray that you would take what we've learned today. Let it translate into our hearts for everyday life, that it would shape us and make us into the men and women you've called us to be. And as we give this offering, I pray that you would use it to enhance your kingdom on this earth. Let it be a seed for what you're going to do here in 2023. We love you and we need you. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, thanks so much. We love you guys. Hope to see you soon.